Here. It's exciting to see you in the Lord's house this morning. We are so grateful that you've chosen this place to gather together as the body of Christ to lift up his name. You may be joining us online, and if so, welcome to you. Or if you're a new person in here today, man, we are excited that you've chosen to join us. We would ask one favor of you. If you're joining us online and this is your first time, would you just pop us an email, please, at info@waterlooroad.org. Or if you're here in this room and you would entrust us with some of your information, there is a connecting card in the pew in front of you. Just fill out whatever you'd like for us to know. And especially if there's any prayer requests that you have that you'd like to share with us, let us join you and come alongside you in prayer. Or if there are ministries of our church that you'd like to know more about, just write those questions on there. And you can put that in the offering box at the back of this room. It's the box on a stick. Back in the back, you can share that with us after the service. Now, this morning, as you came in, you've probably noticed there are several little Lord's Supper cups. Someone was talking about them. It's like the Lord's Supper Lunchable, because it's the, you know, the take and go. If you have not grabbed one of those for yourself and for those in your family, feel free during these next couple of songs to move around, find a table here in the back, here in the front, or up in the balcony. Go ahead and have those elements ready before the sermon, and that way you'll be ready to roll. All right? I want to invite you to stand with me. Let's pray together real quick. I shouldn't have said it like that. Let's pray together and take all the time we need. Lord God, we love you. We glorify your name, Jesus. You are our Savior, our Master, and our King. We praise you for your great love. We celebrate you today and every day. Thank you for calling us together, Lord God. Thank you for this invitation to meet together as your family. And I pray that you'd speak to us now through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's celebrate. Sing, shout, say hallelujah. And let's lift up the name of Jesus. We're here to worship Jesus. Let's do just that. Lift him up.
Come, let us worship the King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. Come see what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. Yes, he has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great.
Done great things in your life. Let's celebrate it together.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, oh Jesus. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great. Yes, God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom. Unshakable. and break every chain, oh God.
Yes,
you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great.
Isn't our Jesus wonderful?
Amen.
Hallelujah. All praise to the Father and the Son. Amen. Amen. You can be seated, church.
Hear this portion of God's story from the book that we love, according to the Gospel of Mark. And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed. So they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the region surrounding Galilee. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen and amen. Well, church, I invite you to stand with me again if you're able. We respond to the word of the Lord by singing the words of the Lord. We're going to be singing the text from Psalm 111 together. I just quickly want to remind you, if you have not grabbed the communion, the Lord's Supper cups, please feel free to move around and grab those now. Let's sing together.
All praise I'll give with all my heart. Bring thanks to God and sing. Come gather all you upright ones. Delight the Lord is King. Enjoy the great works of the Lord. Fail not to see. His righteousness endures, His righteousness endures. In all my memory He has placed just acts and wondrous deeds. Know that the Lord's compassionate love and kind grace is He. Mercy He gives to those who fear. No food they lack or need. Oh, He remembers covenant, provides eternally, provides eternally. Shows His mighty power, rewards with gifts of land, shows us His just and faithful works, trustworthy His law stands. Upright and steadfast are His ways, by extol His holiness. extol his holy.
God, we adore your name. We lift up our holy hands, our hearts, and our hallelujahs to you. Lord Jesus, thank you for taking the penalty of our sin upon yourself on the cross. Lord, I pray that you would remind us of your great mercy now as you speak to us through your word. Bless Pastor Heath. Give him your message for us and let us be receptive to your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. How are we, Waterloo Road? Okay, all right. If you have your Bibles, if you'll turn to Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, while you're turning there, just want to point out, periodically we'll do this, point out different needs that we have as a church, and one of the needs that we currently have are we need more workers in our children's area during our Sunday school time. Yeah, we need a new bass, all right. We need Sunday school worker. We need Awana workers on Wednesday night in our children's area, and what a blessing to be able to have kids in our church. There are lots of churches that aren't not fortunate to have that. There are lots of churches that will die within the next few years if they don't start reaching the next generation. How privileged we are to have kids cry out and kids talk and kids ask questions during our service. They are a blessing, and there's an opportunity for you to serve. We tend to wait for some sort of tingle to go up to our spine before we'll serve. Sometimes the need dictates the area of service. And so if you're interested in that, see Emily about that. She'll talk to you about how you can get hooked up and what the path is for that. And as a reminder, in the year 2021, we're trying to have 2021 gospel conversations. Right? If you've been in the Great Hall, that's what that big display case is. The blue balls that are there, they are the ones that people have had gospel conversations with. And so if you have a gospel conversation, grab a marker and write the name of that person, throw it in the display case, because we're going to try to build that up over the course of a year. And then the white ones are the ones that have been saved and baptized. And so we want to fill that thing up through the end of the year. And we do that by having gospel conversations. So we invite you to have those this week and then help us to fill that display case up. So last week, and as we're working through the book of Colossians, last week, everything was about Jesus, remember? That he is the image of the invisible God. Everything that we talked about was about who Jesus is. And if just as a reminder, it's not the Jesus that we sometimes create. Like sometimes the Jesus we create, he's the one that's sort of just happy with everything that I do. He would never call me out. He would never ask me to do something I don't want to do. He just loves me and accepts me and keeps me just exactly how I am. Well, if we're not careful, we can create this Jesus that's not biblical Jesus. But last week we looked in Colossians 1 and we let Scripture define who Jesus is, but it was all about Jesus. Now this week, the focus is going to shift to us, okay? And it's just as important for us to define ourselves, not who we think we are, not how we think we should be. The culture tells us you can be anything that you want. It doesn't matter. You decide who or what you are. The Bible is going to say otherwise. The Bible is going to say we are defined not by how we see ourselves, but by how God sees us. And so if you have this text, we're going to look at Colossians chapter 1. We're going to begin in verse 21. Or let me just back up. We're going to start in verse 15, okay? Verse 15. It says, he, talking about Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. By Jesus, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Jesus, for Jesus. Jesus is before all things. Jesus holds all things together. Jesus is the head of the body. Jesus is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything Jesus might be preeminent. For in Jesus all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Through Jesus, to reconcile to Jesus all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of Jesus' cross. That's where we were last week. Everything, Jesus. Now, verse 21, and you. You who once were alienated. Let me try to explain what it means to be alienated, what alienation is. So, I've only been here a few months, and so it's still, I guess it's called the honeymoon phase for a new pastor, and so you're probably looking, and I know what you're thinking, like I can see it all in your faces. This guy is just the greatest guy in the world, right? I mean, we hit a home run here, right? Like, that's what you're thinking, okay? But I know this is hard for you to understand, but I've used to be pretty ornery, okay? Used to be pretty ornery, and so whenever I was in high school, I would pull these pranks, okay? And I don't know if it was just that I was a teenage boy, not knowing like where the line is, not to cross or what, but sometimes I'd have a hard time figuring out where the line was and if I was past it or right up to it or what. And so this one particular day, the bell had rung and the teachers were out in the hall monitoring the hall, and all the students were kind of leaving the classes and coming into classes. And so I go into my science room, the science teacher, and we're studying, and I noticed that on his desk, on the desk, they have an overhead projector. Now, for those of you who are younger than me that don't know what an overhead projector is, back in my day, we didn't have these smart boards, these fancy smart boards. We had the dumb projectors, okay? They weren't smart, okay? And so what you would do is you had this projector that had a light on it, and you would put these clear, they were called transparencies, they were like clear paper, like this film, you put it on there, and then whatever you wrote on that transparency would be reflected up to a mirror, and that mirror would bounce an image onto the screen. And so my science teacher, as he was doing whatever he was writing and wanted us to take down, he was writing on this projector. Well, that was what his plan was, at least. So, but while he's out in the hall, me and my buddy, we take some paper towels and we sort of insert it up where the mirror is on this transparency, and then we tape it down where it's gonna stay up there, and so everybody sees what we're doing except for the teacher who's out in the hall monitoring the hall. Well, he comes in and he turns the projector on and he's writing away and just having a good old time, and everybody's snickering because whatever he was seeing here wasn't being projected up onto the wall. And so everybody's snickering, and so he's like, "That's odd. I just used this last class, and it was working fine." And so he's like saying that to himself, and he's like looking five minutes trying to figure out what's going on. And finally, he gets up to where the mirror is, and kind of sort of takes it down where he could see, and he noticed that there are paper towels taped to the mirror where what he's doing can't be projected onto the screen. I don't know if he had a bad day or what the deal was, but he said, "I want whoever did this out of my class." Okay, and so I remember getting up, the walk of shame. Everybody knew we did it. The walk of shame, going down to the principal's office. And by the way, that was the first time I ever got sent to the principal's office. Okay, so I'm in the principal's office, and the teacher comes down, and he says, "You are out of my class, okay? For you to get back into my class, you have to write an essay explaining why I, as your teacher, should allow you back into my class." And all I remembered was just the oddness of sitting in this office trying to think of a reason, trying to fill a whole page of reasons on why he should let me back in the class for the prank that I had just pulled. But the point is, I was over here separated from the rest of the class. I was cut off from the rest of the class, and something had to happen for me to move from where I was back into the class. That is sort of what alienation is. That we are cut off from our people. We are, but more importantly, this text is going to point out that we are cut off from God. Not just from each other. We are cut off from God. We are alienated. We are cut off. That is all of our condition. That's all of our condition before Christ. We tend to think that we are pretty good people. That just needs a little bit of God. And like here's what most of the parents think. They're like over on this camp thinking that, "Well, my little Johnny, he can never do anything wrong. And if he did, that's your fault. Like if it was today, my teacher would somehow get in trouble for my parents for me putting that up on, like, that's because little Johnny, he can never do anything wrong. Right? That's sort of the perception that we have. But Scripture's going to teach us that every one of us, your sweet, dear little Johnny, if he doesn't give his life to the Lord, will be separated from God and everything that's good for all eternity. That we are cut off. We are cut off from a good God. We are alienated from him. Ephesians 2 is going to describe it this way. It's going to say that we were dead in our sins and trespasses. Now, as I was driving in this morning, I was looking, because it is Oklahoma, and I knew, and sure enough, I wasn't disappointed. I was driving in on I-35 before I got to Waterloo, and I noticed on the side of the road a dead raccoon. It's Oklahoma. You know what that raccoon was not doing? He wasn't breathing. He wasn't eating, he wasn't playing, he didn't get just tired along the way and decided to take a nap. He was dead. And there was nothing he could do about it. Even if somehow, in his dead state, he thought, you know what, I think I'm going to start breathing again. It is impossible, because he's dead. Scripture says that you and I, in our alienation, our us being cut off from God, that's our condition. And there's nothing we can do about it. In fact, Ephesians 2 is going to go on to say that simply by being born, we are objects of God's wrath. Our sinfulness is that big a deal. We are cut off. We are alienated. But look what happens. Something happens. Verse 21, you are alienated, hostile in mind, doing deeds. Something happens. He has now reconciled you in his body and flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. So like, the things have been weird the last year with the virus and with work and with working from home, and then all of a sudden jobs not being available. And imagine you being the one that lost your job, okay? And imagine there not being any sort of unemployment to benefit from. Imagine you not being able to get another job. You know what's going to happen? Sooner or later, the bank's going to come to your door, and they're going to start knocking on your door and say, you got to give up your house. You got to give up your car, because you have this debt you cannot pay. Now imagine in that moment, they're coming to knock on your door, and somebody walking in, the preacher, right? Because he's awesome, right? Just kidding. Imagine somebody walking up and knocking on you, and right when they're about to say, give me the keys. Imagine somebody out of the blue coming in and saying, I'll cover that loan. Not just this month, I'll cover the entire payment. He owes nothing. She owes nothing. That's reconciliation. That's what it means to be reconciled, that whatever debt we have that we cannot pay, Jesus takes care of. The idea of reconciliation is that Jesus does for us what we could never do for ourselves. In this text here in verse 22, it says that he has now reconciled us, that he has paid the debt. Listen, he doesn't just enable us to be reconciled, he reconciles us. There's a big difference there. He doesn't just enable it to happen, he actually reconciles us. And so what we're talking about this morning, what we're looking at what it means to move from alienation, from being cut off, to being reconciled with a good, holy, demanding God. What it looks like and what that leads to for us. You guys with me? Okay. Number one. Here's what happens when we move from alienation to reconciliation. Here's what happens. Number one, Jesus changes our minds. He changes our minds. So look what it says in verse 21. You who were once alienated and hostile in mind, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death. See, what happens when he moves us from being cut off, when he moves us from alienation to reconciliation, he changes our minds. Listen, if you are a believer today, it's because your mind has been changed from a hostility towards God, no need for God, to now a need for God. He changes our minds. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says that Satan blinds the minds of the unbeliever. See, before we become a Christian, we see no need for Christ. It's not that big of a deal. Maybe we don't think about it at all, or if we do, we're like, well, maybe I'll give my life to the Lord someday. Like, we see no need for God. We just want to sort of do our own thing, live our own life. No one tells me what to do. But when we move from being alienated into a reconciled, right relationship with him, he changes our mind about Jesus. All of a sudden, we need Jesus. All of a sudden, we need to turn from our sins and embrace Jesus. All of a sudden, we want to follow Jesus. We want to live for Jesus. That's what happens when we move from alienation to reconciliation. He changes our minds about Jesus. He changes our minds about sin. You ever notice how convenient it is to point out other people's sins, right? Like what he's doing wrong, what she's doing wrong. Can you believe how evil, how sinful they are, right? And have you ever noticed how it's like our own sins? It's like, oh, that's not that big a deal. It's not really a lie. It's just I just bent the truth a little bit, right? See, we tend to think that what I'm doing, my sin, my displeasing of the Lord, it's not that big of a deal. But here's what happens over time when we give our life to the Lord, when we move from alienation to reconciliation. He changes our mind. Listen, not even so much about everyone else, but about what's going on in here. About our very own sin. He changes our mind about sin. Some of the things I used to do, I no longer do. Because he's changed my mind about it. He changes our mind about other people. So much so that when we see a lost, hurting, broken world that oftentimes is hostile towards us, he changes our mind from retaliation to compassion towards that person. He reminds us that but for the grace of God, go I. That would be me. That would be me if he hadn't changed my mind. He hadn't changed who I was. And he changes that we don't see people as the enemy, but we see them as a image bearer of God in desperate need of being reconciled. We see them as being alienated in desperate need of being reconciled. He changes our minds about issues. How do you know how to vote this way or to vote that way or to be for this or to be against that? How do you know? Because over time, as we walk with him, he changes our minds, aligning us underneath who he is, what he's about, what he wants us to do. We move from alienation to reconciliation. Jesus changes our minds. We move from hostility to being reconciled. If he doesn't change your mind, if he hasn't changed your mind, Paul would question whether or not you're following the Jesus of the Bible, or maybe some other Jesus you've created. When we move from alienation to reconciliation, Jesus changes our mind. Number two, Jesus changes our conduct. He changes our conduct. Look at verse 21. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. So it's not just our thoughts, it's our actions. Doing evil deeds. He's now reconciled in his body of his flesh by his death. Jesus changes our conduct. He changes our actions. I can say with certainty that in some things, I'm not as sinful as I used to be. Now, ask anyone, ask my wife. I've got a long way to go. I got a long way to go. But there are certain things I'm not as sinful in as I used to be because Jesus changes our conduct. He gets specific. Paul gets specific in verse 22. He's now reconciled in the body of his flesh by his death in order to present you holy. He changes us to be holy. Well, that's a heavy word, isn't it? Holy. That's a word that God reserves for himself in Scripture. You're like this, and that person's like this. All people are like this. And then there's God over here who's different. He's holy. He's set apart. And God takes a broken, sinful people and changes the mind and changes the actions and then makes us holy. Look, just like his son. Over time, you should look more like Jesus than you did when you first gave your life to him. He changes our actions. One of the actions, he changes us to be holy. There's another action he changes us to in verse 22. In order to present you holy and blameless. Blameless. Now, this has a lot to do with how God sees us because we still battle the flesh. Like I don't know if it's just a preacher thing, but I feel kind of like Paul when he's like, the things I want to do, I don't find myself doing. The things I don't want to do, that's what I do. Whenever we move from alienation to reconciliation, when God looks at us, he no longer sees us in our sinful brokenness, but he sees his son and his death that he gave for us on the cross. And he sees us as blameless. There's another action. He changes our conduct. There's another action here in verse 22. He's reconciled us in the body of his flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. Above reproach, that means that no one can look on your life and say anything evil about you. Someone who lives above reproach, you would say of him, he is an honorable man. You'd say of her, she is an honorable woman. And listen, this is not just like this, in this language here, it's speaking of how God views us, but listen, we're commanded to live above reproach to a world that's watching us. In other words, a culture, a hostile, lost culture should not be able to look at you or me as a Christian and say anything but, he's an honorable man. She's an honorable woman. Which, if that's the case, makes us think, what, do I post that? Do I need to post this? Do I say it that way? We have a world that's very hostile towards Christians right now. A lot of it's based off of how we're coming across. Here's what Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 2. He says, conduct yourselves in an honorable way among the Gentiles. Keep that conduct honorable, so that when they speak evil of you, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. This visitation. So even the lost should be able to look at us, and if they speak evil of us, they should have to backtrack. They should have to backtrack when they see our conduct. It should bring honor to our Lord. He changes our conduct. He changes our actions. We're changed to be holy. We're changed to be blameless. We're changed to be above reproach. That verse 22, what it's saying, it's the whole key in this is that it's his death. It's his death that causes us to be reconciled. It says that he presents us. He presents us this way. Because of his death, Jesus presents us holy and blameless. Listen, not our efforts. What I'm not saying is, hey, pull yourself up by your bootstraps and get it done. Stop thinking that way. Stop acting that way. That's what we tell our kids, right? Stop acting that way. According to this text, it's not your effort that leads to a changed mind or a changed action. It's just what Jesus, it's just what he does. If you go home and you put a cup of water in your freezer, in time it's going to be frozen. If you take that block of ice and put it in a pot on your stove and turn the heat up, in just a little bit, it's going to melt and then boil. And if you leave it long enough, it's going to evaporate because it's going to change. That's just the property of water. The property of one that's gone from alienation to reconciliation, just the thing that happens, is that he changes our minds. And he changes our actions. Now, verse 23 sort of gets real, okay? Verse 23. You're moved from alienation to reconciliation. Verse 23. If indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under the heaven, of which I, Paul, became a minister. Now let me explain what Paul's not saying before we talk about what he is saying. What Paul is not saying is that, hey, you want to stay reconciled? As long as you continue in the faith, you'll stay reconciled. But if you don't continue in the faith, you're no longer reconciled. What Paul's not saying is that this effort is dependent upon you. Rather, the language that Paul is using here is this language of self-examination. The language of self-examination, what Paul's saying is, hey, do you want to know? Do you really want to know if you've been reconciled? Because honestly, some of us are going to say, yeah, I've been reconciled. I've been saved because I prayed that prayer way back when I was 7. And like for 30 years, there's been nothing. No changing of the mind, no changing of the action, nothing. But I'm good because I prayed that prayer when I was 7. The language that Paul's using here is saying, hey, if you really want to know where you stand with the Lord, here's the test. Here's the self-examination. And then he explains, what does it mean to continue? What does it mean to continue in the faith? What does it mean to not shift from the hope of the gospel? Well, he's going to explain it here. He's going to explain what it means to continue in the faith. That's the language he used, verse 23. If you continue in the faith, and he's going to explain what that means. Look what he says, verse 23, stable and steadfast. There's a self-examination right there. There's the test. There's how I know if I'm living alienation or not. If I'm steady and steadfast in my growth. So whenever I was an early Christian, right, in the teenage years and going to Falls Creek, like I'd roll into Falls Creek sort of being like at a spiritual low. You guys remember that if you've been? Spiritual low. And then I'd spend all week in scripture and worship and with the church body and hearing from the Lord. No wonder I'm up here, right, when I leave. Okay, then I come back. I'm on this spiritual high, but I don't spend much time reading the word. And temptation hits me like a Mack truck, right? And all these things, and so I'm going down here. And then I'll go to another conference, or I'll go back to Falls Creek, and then I'm right here. So for years, it's like all these highs and lows, right? Where fast forward now to where I'm 38 and been a Christian for 31 years, and it's there's still the highs and lows, but the highs and lows are like this. Rather than these big swings, right? That's what Paul's looking for here whenever he speaks of someone moving from alienation um, to, to reconciliation is that there's steady, that there's this growth, that we're still in the flesh, that there's still these seasons where we dip, but we're steady and we're stable and we're growing, and the dips aren't nearly as low whenever Christ changes us. That we continue in the faith. That's the litmus test. Something else he says here in verse 23, he also says, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard. Friend, do you remember what it was like when you gave your life to the Lord? I grew up in church, and I don't really have a memory of not loving God. But I can take you to a small church in Indiahoma. I can point to exactly where I was sitting when that night the Holy Spirit got a hold of me. And it wasn't a salvation message. And I didn't give my life to the Lord right then. I went home, talked with my parents, talked with my pastor, and that night I gave my life to the Lord in my kitchen. And I was on cloud nine. You remember what it was like when you heard the gospel for the first time? Listen, not in one ear and out the other, but do you remember when you heard it and it stuck? Went to school as a 7-year-old. And here's the only thing I knew how to say. I asked Jesus into my heart. I'm getting baptized in a couple weeks. You should too. That was my conversation in the playground with kids. Because I was so excited. Whenever I was 14 at Falls Creek, and the Lord was calling me to ministry. Listen, it was a similar experience, but maybe a different emotion. Because I felt as if I felt like God was calling me to ministry. I felt like I'd said no. And I remember just being so floored that God would want someone like me to take his word. And I bawled my eyes out. I can take you to the steps at Doherty Cabin. I can take you to the steps where I was sitting when God called me to ministry, and I said yes. But like a low emotion that then got happy. So see, like your salvation, like it might have been like that for you. It might have been like this incredible high or this incredible low for a moment or a million things in between. But can you go back? Can you go back to what it was like when you remembered the good news that Christ would save you if you cried out to him? You know what Paul's message is here? Don't ever move past that. Don't ever move past the gospel. There's nothing past the gospel. I don't know where, somewhere along the way we decided, okay, Christ saves me, and then it's my job the rest of my life to sort of come to church and listen to some guy yell at us and listen to some guy kind of, or girl, you know, teach us a lesson in Sunday school. That's kind of the warm-up, right? Warm up to the sermon. And we sing and we stand. And that's what I guess that's my job as a Christian. Like my job after he saves me is to learn all this stuff. Paul says, never move past the hope of the gospel that you heard. There's nothing past the gospel. Never move past repentance. I remember sort of as a teen struggling with this or that. I remember thinking, oh, I can't, you know, 5 years from now, I'm not going to be struggling with this. 10 years from now. I can't wait till I'm married. I won't be struggling. I can't wait till I have kids. I won't be struggling. Can't wait till I have a job. Then I won't be struggling. Can't wait till I won't be struggling. Well, ultimately, what I was ready to stop repenting, right? Oh, God, God, I feel like I've got to repent to you all the time. I'm ready to be past that. You know what I found? I found the opposite to be true. That the closer I get to the Lord, the more he refines me, the more he changes my mind, the more he changes my conduct. Somehow I'm repenting more, I feel like, now than way back here when I was struggling with all this junk. You know why? It's because the closer we get to the Lord, the more we realize that he's God and we're not. And that repentance is ongoing in the life of a believer. So Paul's saying, hey, the believer never moves past the repentance. I think I think in the Baptist church, this little altar call that we do, I think we've got it backwards somehow. I think we're like, okay, that's the place people go. People walk the aisle. People come pray whenever they're ready to get saved. And certainly that's true. We've treated it as a place that lost people come, not where the saved people are reminded. And Paul's saying, you want to know what it looks like to continue in the faith, to not shift from the hope of the gospel? It's never moving past it, never moving past our need for his grace. Believers continue. They don't shift from this posture of repentance. Let me ask you, have you been reconciled? Has he, over time, changed your mind? Is he changing your mind? Is he changing your conduct? Are you continuing steadfast in the faith? Are you not moving on from this posture of repentance? Have you been reconciled? Have you been saved? The good news of the gospel is that when we come to the end of playing games or come to the end of ourselves and cry out to him, he saves us by the work he's already done, his work on the cross. And if you're here and you've been struggling with this, whether or not you've been moved from alienation to reconciliation, you've been struggling with this, you don't have to be on today. Or maybe you're confident that you need to give your life to the Lord. In a second, we're going to have a time of response. There's men and women ready to pray with you back here. Answer any questions you might have. I'll be right here in the front. You can come sit by me and we'll go back and talk together. I'm not going to do anything to embarrass you. But you want to be sure. If you're here and you want to be sure that you're giving your life to the Lord, you don't want to deal with carry the doubt anymore, you can be saved. You can have that confidence today. And believer, we're about to have communion. We're about to celebrate what Christ has done, what his death on the cross accomplished for us. That's what communion's about. Who is communion for? It's for those who have committed their life to Christ. Paul warns about doing it rightly. He warns that it is for those who have given their life to Christ. He warns that it is for believers who are walking in repentance. And so if you're a believer here today and you've blown it this week, you know what the idea is? That you would repent and you'd be reminded what his death already paid for you. And you'd realign your life back underneath his lordship. And if you're a believer here today and you're like, yeah, I've sinned this week, but I'm just going to keep doing it, Lord's Supper is not for you. He warns of us taking it rightly as we remember his blood that was shed, his body that was broken, so that we can move from alienation to reconciliation. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We pray that it will have its effect in us today. We pray for We praise you for moving us from alienation to reconciliation. We praise you for changed minds and changed actions. And God, we fully acknowledge that even as believers, there's still areas that you need to work through us in. And so God, where as believers, where our minds have been sinful this week, pray that we confess that to you and we turn from that. Where our actions have been sinful this week, we pray that we turn from that and follow you. We're grateful that you use this time in your word to sharpen us and to change us forever. Pray for the person who's not given their life to you or who has struggled with doubt, maybe gone through the motions, but never has truly given their life to you, that they'll have courage to trust you today. Love you. Pray that you have your way during this time. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, stand with me. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. We sing hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. We shout hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Let's celebrate that. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. We cry hallelujah. Yeah, celebrate your hope, church. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hey, church, you can be seated. As we enter into this time of communion, I want to make sure that you know, if you don't have the elements, go ahead, feel free to go ahead and grab those. There's tables in each aisle. And just so you know, there's a top layer, right, and a bottom layer. Top layer to get to the wafer here, and the bottom layer to get to the juice there. So this is a reminder. This is to remember what Jesus has done, as we sang in that song moments ago, this living hope that we have, to be reminded of that and to go out and to live it. And so here's what I want to do before we dive into this time is I want us to have a time of prayer and, as Pastor Heath mentioned, a time of preparation and examination. And so I'm going to ask for you just to bow your heads for just a moment and just spend some time allowing the Holy Spirit to examine your heart before you take of these elements, repenting of sin, and I'll close this in prayer. Father, we're thankful for this time. We can come and worship you together. Thankful for the sacrifice of your Son on the cross on our behalf. God, so that we can stand before you holy and blameless. Thank you for God, your Son's body that was crucified on the cross, the blood that was spilled for our forgiveness, for our reconciliation. Pray that you would forgive us where we have fallen short of what you've commanded us to do and to be. God, may we take of these elements with a heart that is true and honest and repentant before you. And that we also celebrate your goodness and your grace and your faithfulness to us. I ask all this in your Son's name. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting in verse 23, Paul says this: "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Church, in a year where we're having gospel conversations, what a great testimony for us to go and to proclaim this good news, that Jesus' blood has been shed, his body shed on the cross for us, for our forgiveness, for our reconciliation, and is our living hope. Let us be a people that go out and we proclaim that testimony to a world that desperately needs to hear that around us.
Amen. Church, I invite you to stand again. Let's praise the Lord for his great grace for us.
Grace, what have you done? Murdered for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong. My sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your blood breaks my fall. The scandal of grace, you died in my place. Oh, my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside. Forever the hope in my heart. The cross has taught me to live, and mercy my heart now to see. Well, the day and its troubles shall come, but I know that your strength is enough. The scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul.
Church family, just a couple things on our way out. I want to make sure that you know, first and foremost, as you are here with us in person, we do have offering boxes all throughout our church. I'm looking at a couple here out in our foyer and down in our great hall. And so if you have tithes or offerings this morning, we want to make sure you do that. If you're watching online with us, you can go to waterlooroad.org/giving. And you'll be able to give from our website platform or text the number 405-467-2323. Follow the prompts there and you'll get you situated up there as well. This weekend we've got coming up our student weekend. So first and foremost, at church congregation, would you be praying for that weekend? Pray for lives to be saved, for God to draw people to himself, draw students to himself. And if you haven't been signed up yet, if you haven't got signed up yet, your kiddos, 7th grade through 12th grade, make sure you do that ASAP for this weekend. You won't want to miss some of those things happening. And then also this week, there is a thing called Rose Day, and for us Baptists and really for those wanting to rally around pro-life, this pro-life movement, our Rose Day is there on February the 3rd this week. Many of you have heard that or have seen that it's gone virtual. So be looking for a link, a virtual link in some of our social media, and let us know if we can help out with any of those things. We sure would love to celebrate life in Christ and be able to speak for those who can't speak for themselves. Amen. That's what we're about at Waterloo Road. On our way out this morning, I do want to challenge you with something. So as you guys have seen for the past few weeks, we got a little bit raw wood happening on the stage, right? And I'm assuming some of you like that, a little bit rough and manly, maybe a little bit. We're going to cover this week and with some carpet. So when you come in next Sunday, it's going to look a lot different. But what I do want to do is take advantage of an opportunity here with this raw wood. The first service did exceedingly well, and I know you will too. But I want us to take these Sharpies that we've got here at these steps, and I want us to write a prayer for this next generation. I want to write prayers of of God's movement in the city of Edmond and beyond, that what is spoken from this platform and praise and worship would reach around the world. And so if you would be so called as a family, I think this would be a great opportunity for you and your family to come grab a Sharpie, write down a prayer of proclamation, of adoration, and I truly believe our Lord will be glorified, and we'll cover that up this week, and we'll go from there, all right? Well, church family, let me pray for us, and we'll be dismissed this morning. Father, you are so good to us. We're so thankful that you would look down upon us, that you would call us your people, you would unite us together as your body. Father, we thank you that you've called us out of alienation and into reconciliation. We know that salvation only comes from you. And so, Jesus, we praise you. Holy Spirit, we thank you for filling this place of worship this morning. We pray that as we are exiting today, that you would fill us with everything we need on a daily basis to bring glory to you. Help us as we speak the truth of the gospel and our gospel conversations on a daily basis, and that you're praised as we do so. Lord, we love you. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Come grab a Sharpie and write down a prayer, and you're dismissed.